Deliverance Revival Tabernacle Church presents The Time Is Now with Pastor E.I. Osborne Jr. and friends, reaching souls unlimited with the gospel of Jesus Christ, raising up Jesus believers throughout New England, the nation, Canada, and the world. And now, our pastor, E.I. Osborne Jr.
Well, praise the name of Jesus, for he's worthy to be praised. I'm Pastor Osborne. I'd like to welcome you to another edition of The Time Is Now radio and television program. It's my prayer and sincere hope that God will use this program and use us right now as an instrument to minister to your needs. And I'm certain that God is going to do just that. We have a word that we're going to share with you today. And there's several things that I really want to talk to you about. The other day, I think I'm going to get into this a little bit right now, again. Now, I had a dream. And there was a specific person in the dream. I know who they are and all that kind of stuff. But I just felt led on Sunday, at least in Boston. I didn't say it in Plymouth. Maybe I'll say it this Sunday. But I felt impressed to just not tell the person, individual, but to tell it to the church. Because really, this dream, it fit me. It probably fits you and a whole lot of people, okay, within the body of Christ. And so I'm going to tell you about this dream that I had. I think it's going to help you because right now, someone is crying out for change, financial change, physical change in your health, spiritual change, and so on. And God wants to bring about the change that you desire, all right? And I think this is going to help you. Someone, you know, you're praying for different things, and for some reason, things aren't happening, you're not seeing what you need. It's going to help you. So I'll get into that in just a second. But we thank God for you. We hope you're enjoying the program, the word. If you are, to God be all the glory. We'd love to have you come fellowship with us. We have services on Sunday morning in Plymouth at 8:30, and again at 12 o'clock in Boston and Dorchester at 113 Harold Street. So call the, well, website's on the screen. So go to website eiosborne.org. You'll find the times, locations of services. You can send your prayer requests, comments, and so on. Or you can call us on the information prayer line, 508-746-4085, or correspond with us by mail at The Time Is Now, Post Office Box 3642, Plymouth, Massachusetts, 02361, okay? And I'll say something before we pray. Just today, a young lady called from out of state who said she was watching one of our messages, one of our videos on YouTube. And I thought that was very interesting. You know, we do get some prayer requests and different things, letters or whatever from people locally and all like that. But it was interesting that in this case, someone called the prayer line for prayer after watching a video on YouTube. So I'll just say we are on YouTube under E.I. Osborne, okay? So if you want to watch some of these messages, if we're not in your area, you can't see us on cable, in your area, and you'd like to watch the program, okay? You may be listening by on radio or whatever the case is, or maybe there's a message you'd like to hear again or something new. Go to YouTube and you know, search us, E.I. Osborne. You'll see about 49, 50 videos, about 50, some old, some newer. But that's a resource, but thank God for this young lady. It was very encouraging to hear that today. Okay, so Father, thank you for this opportunity to minister to those who have listening and watching right now. I know that you're good, and I know you're good all the time. We ask you to bless your people, touch, heal, save, deliver, and set free right now for your glory and your glory alone. And I pray for people who may be sick, suffering, and afflicted, those who are dealing with sickness, and I feel right now those people who are dealing with terminal illness. The doctor has determined and has said that it's terminal, but I speak against that right now. I pray against it in the name of Jesus, and I say you shall not die, but you shall live. That 30-day death sentence, that 3-week death sentence, that 10-day death sentence that has been pronounced over you, I rebuke that. I cast it down in the name of Jesus, and I speak life, life, and that more abundantly. I say live, 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 live right now in Jesus' name. And I say you shall not die, but you shall live, and you shall declare the works of the Lord in the land of the living. And I thank you, Father, that you are doing for people right now the things that they're unable to do for themselves for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Isn't that great? That's awesome. Now, So I guess I'll just tell you about this dream. First of all, let me tell you this. In John 10 and verse 4 and 5, Jesus says, he talks about the sheep follow him because they know his voice. It says they won't follow a stranger because they don't know the voice of strangers. And one of the things that right now I think TBN is doing a special on knowing God's voice, and they're offering some books, one by Robert Morris and another young lady, I can't think of her name. But the interesting thing is this, I heard Robert Morris talking about knowing God's voice. We've ministered about knowing God's voice, and it's so important not just to know his word, but know his voice. See, because a lot of people know God's word, and even those people who know God's word are deceived. Because the person or people deceiving them use the word. And so you just agree, well, it's the word, so, well, but is it God's voice? I'll say this to you real quick. God is a spirit. And so here's what happens. When God speaks, you don't just hear it in your ears, your natural ear. You hear it, it registers in your spirit. So you go to church Sunday, your pastor's talking about something or whatever, and you hear it, and you hear it, and it's a great word, and you say, ooh, you're excited. Ooh, pastor, yeah, he's preaching today. Yeah, you hear it, But all of a sudden he says something, and guess what? You go from hearing it to hearing it. See, hearing it to hearing it. It hits your spirit. Maybe with some conviction. Not condemnation, but conviction. You're convicted of something. Or it's direction, it's instruction. You heard all this stuff he said about something that's going on with the church. You didn't feel impressed to volunteer, but all of a sudden you went from hearing it to hearing it. You see? Because it registered where? In your spirit. But let me say this just real quick, because I got to move on. So now, and what I'm saying, hearing it to hearing it, if you're not watching on television, I'm going from pointing to my ears to pointing to the seat of your soul, your heart, your spirit, whatever, your inside. I'm pointing to the inner man. I'm doing a little motion if you're watching by radio. You go from, I'll say it this way. You go from hearing it in your ears to hearing it in your spirit. To those who are watching by television, don't see me pointing from one place to the other, all right? So you go from hearing it in your ear, your natural ear, to hearing it in your spiritual ear. And you know, wow, I'm supposed to do that. I know I'm supposed to whatever, because it's not something you're hearing in your natural ear anymore. But here's the deal. The other day God spoke to me and it said, the reason, I'll say it this way, the reason you can recognize your natural father's voice, over every other voice, male voice, you know, it's not, listen, you know, unless he has a voice, he sounds like Elmo or Kermit the Frog or something, you know, like, Elmo, you know, now let's, he didn't sound like that, but let's say he did. It's not because he had a voice like Elmo, all right, that I go, oh, that's my dad, no. So the reason I know his voice, my natural father's voice, over every other male voice, decent male voice, right, is because I spent time. I've heard his voice from the time I was came out the womb till the time he went home to be with the Lord. So I could be in a crowded room with all a bunch of men and whatever. My dad could be on the other side of the room, and maybe a bunch of them say my name at once. But I tell you what, I will know his voice over every other voice. Why? Because I've spent time. The time that I spent with him makes his voice speaks, you know, a plain and whatever, distinguishable over every other voice only because I've heard his voice more than any other voice. I'm familiar, that familiar with it. Okay, you want to know God's voice? Read all the books, follow all the instructions, even what I just said about hearing, going from hearing in your natural ear to your spiritual ear, God's a spirit, he speaks to your spirit, all the things I've taught and told you or whatever. It comes down really to one simple thing. You got to spend time with God. And that's what God told me to tell you. The same way I can distinguish my natural father's voice over every other voice is not because he spoke to my spirit or anything, it's because I spent time with him. And my time with him causes his voice to become my sister's voice, my brother's voice, everybody in my family, or even friends. Matter of fact, I'll tell you something. The other day, and I might have said this before, but the other day I was in the studio and someone was in here ahead of us, whatever, and they were leaving, and I was talking to one person who knew me. The other person didn't know me. But the person that didn't know me said, what's your name? And I said who I was. They said, you know what they said? Wow, I recognize your voice. I listened to you on radio. Now, they didn't know who I was. They didn't know me. The other person's talking to me, never mentioned my name or whatever, but the person looked at me and said, what's your name? And I said my name. And they said, wow, I recognized your voice. I listened to you on radio. Imagine that. They listened to me on radio, never seen me, listened on radio, and they knew who I was because of my voice. That's what God needs. They listen to me all the time. So here's what they recognize, my voice. I spent time. You got to spend time with God. Turn off the television, the radio, you know, stop, you know, whatever you're doing. Get up earlier, go to bed later, you know, take a shorter lunch break, whatever. Get in God's presence. Let me move on. So now, the dream. The other day, I was, matter of fact, it was maybe Saturday night, waking up from a dream, out of sleep in this dream. Could have been more like, even like a vision. In the dream, there was a particular person, and they were having all these problems. But the thing about the problems was that it was a problem that they kept having over and over. And someone watching right now, that's your situation. You seem to just keep, it's like a revolving door. It's like a cycle. You just keep having the same problems over and over and over. And you're praying to God and you're saying, oh, Lord, change. This thing just, every time I turn around, the same thing over and over and over and over and whatever. And, you know, the interesting thing about change is this. If you're asking God to change, you need change. If you need change, I'm going to tell you the very simple way to bring about change. You want to know? Listen, if you need change, you want change right now, here's what you do. Are you listening? Here's what you do. Change. That's it. Change. You want change? Change. If I said, man, I got this suit, this jacket all dirty, man, my jacket's dirty, I need to change it. Guess what I'd have to do? Just change it. And it's changed. So now, but maybe it's a little deeper than that. So let me move on. Don't get mad yet. There's plenty, gonna be plenty for you to get upset about. It's too early. But here's what happens. So in the dream, this person dealing with the same thing, like a cycle, just every time you turn around, here it is, and they're praying, Lord, whatever. So what happens is God sends someone to them, and the person says to them, the reason you keep dealing with this same problem over and over and over, and it just keeps returning, it's like a cycle or whatever, and you're tired of, you want change like that. They said the reason that's happening is because of your choices. You keep making the same choices. You keep making the same bad choices over and over. You know, some women, they keep marrying the same type of guy. And you know, or they keep dating the same kind of guy. They keep, some people, some men, some women, some people, but they just keep doing the same thing. You know, and you know, whether you realize it or not, I think I'm a little insane, at least after this word and this dream, I'm pretty sure I am, because, you know, the definition of insanity, one of the definitions of insanity is to keep doing the same thing and expect a different result. I'm not saying you're insane, but if the shoe fits, the definition fits. But what happens is, I'm making no friends today, but that's okay, I'm used to that. But the thing is, so the dream, the person's just, you know, the God sends the word through a person, hey, the reason you keep having these problems, the same problems, it seems like over and over, is because it's your choices. You keep making the same choices. And not only that, God wants to help you, and he desires to help you or whatever, but he can't because you're not following the instructions that he's given you. So what happened next was the person that was being told that, here's what they did. They got mad. They got upset about what the person said to them and all that. And then, you know, upset and all that kind of stuff. Not just angry like mad, but mad, angry, upset, and so on. And then what they did was this. They started to make excuses. Yeah, well, I know, and they start making excuses for why they make the decisions and why they've made the decisions and why they make the decisions. And so they started making, so they heard the word, and it was a word from God, and they got angry about it, and then made excuses for why they do what they've done, what they do and do what they do and all that. So, all right, so then God then says, this is a word for me, and God says to them, see, God basically says, that's why I can't help you. Because when I sent you this word, you got angry about it, upset about it, and so on, and then you made excuses. And there are many people today struggling. As a pastor, people come to me, they got different issues and problems or whatever. What do I do? Pray for me or whatever. And I tell you what, for many people, it really just comes down to your choices. Listen, Satan, your adversary, is not all powerful. And the only power he has over you is the power you give him. And you give him that power over you, not authority, but power, when you make choices that allows him to do whatever he's doing. Okay? So God then sends a word, instruction, as he has throughout the scripture. When people needed help, he sent instructions. People need healing, provisions, and so on and all like that. He sends instructions. Now, for the person that follows the instruction, they get the help they need. For the person that won't, well, they stay in the cycle. And for some of you, God has you watching right now because you're in the cycle. And the cycle is not, you know, I'm not going to tell you stop praying against the devil because you should. But when you're done praying, you need to change. You need to stop doing what you're doing that's allowing him to do what he's doing. Okay? So you're creating the problem. And that's what God is saying. And right now, even as I'm telling you this, you're angry. And it's not the first time you've been angry. You've been angry before when other people, your mother, your father, your friends, or someone has tried to tell you this, a teacher, a professor, and you know what? You get angry. A coach, you get angry. And it's your anger that's hindering your deliverance. It's your anger that's hindering the answer. So instead of getting angry and upset and then make excuses, well, see, because some people, they have an excuse. I didn't have a father. Well, you know what? There's a lot of people that didn't have a father. You know, well, you know, you have excuses. Well, we were poor. There was a lot of poor people. We were rich. There's a lot of rich people. You know, there was a guy the other day, not long ago, he tried to claim his richness, his being wealthy, growing up wealthy, inhibited his ability to know right from wrong. It was a cup case like that. You probably know what I'm talking about. So he had an excuse. He said he was drunk, driving, killed somebody, whatever he did. And he says because he grew up rich and he's so privileged, he didn't understand right or wrong. He used that as a defense. Can you imagine that? So everybody has an excuse. They're like excuses or like noses. I'll use that. That's safe. Everybody has one, right? So what happens, though, is here's God trying to help you. Send your word. You get angry. So God stepped in the dream. God stepped in himself and said, hey, you know, I'm trying to help you, but you know, you're not listening, and you get angry, and then you make excuses. So there are people right now, you might live in a house with other people, grown folks, who don't pay any rent, no bills, they're laying up in the house while you're at work, and here's what you do. You come home, you cook, you clean, you pay all the bills, you do all the stuff, and they do absolutely nothing. And yeah, you get mad about it, you fuss, you go in the room and cry, and you cry out to God to help you. And God keeps telling you, you change. Let the lights go off and stay off and see what happens. You see? Well, I don't want to be in the dark. Well, until you change, nobody around you is going to change. You're enabling. But whatever the case is. So let's talk about some. Let's move on to another instance. So some people want to be healed. There are people right now suffering from type 2 diabetes or high blood pressure or whatever. And I know I'm in your Kool-Aid right now, but hey. What can I say? So now, you know, you're struggling. Listen, you're struggling with something that you could fix. You could fix. Now, there are people with conditions and whatever that the medications or whatever, or it's type 1 diabetic or whatever, or they were born that way. Something's wrong with the pancreas, some organ, whatever. So that's they need healing. There's something they can't do for themselves. But there are many people who have been helped and have been delivered and have been set free by changing their lifestyle, getting some exercise, losing some weight, change their diet, and so on and so on. And the doctors have told you that. You know you can do it. You've heard other people do it. There's books on it and so on and so on. But for some reason, you're crying out to God. And here's the question. Should God do for you the thing that you can do for yourself? Well, he can, but should he? I think if God were to do that, it's not helping you because you're still going to continue to destroy yourself with the lifestyle and the things that you're doing. You're still going to, because listen, you know, all that stuff you're doing, all the sugar, whatever, the bad lifestyle, it's going to kill you. Okay? So, you know, maybe what you should do is listen. So let me give you some examples. John chapter 5, there was a man sitting at the pool of Bethesda, one or the other. So Jesus comes, wilt thou be made whole? The man says, sir, I have nobody to put me in the pool. He's called the impotent man. And he says, when the water's troubled, because an angel came down, troubled the water, whoever stepped in first was healed. Been there 38 years. I've heard people preach that for 38 years, he was laying there. He should have been able to roll down to the water. And I've heard all that stuff preached. I don't know what the man's situation was. All I know is he was there for 38 years. And he felt he couldn't get down there. Maybe it's very possible he could not. So Jesus comes along, though, and says, wilt thou be made whole? Man says, makes excuses. Lord, I have nobody to put me, no, I have no one to help me to get me into water when it's trouble. What did the man do? Wilt thou be made whole? What did the man, first thing he does is what? Lord, I have nobody to help me. You know what he made? Excuses. Well, that sounds familiar. Then, so Jesus' instruction to him is this. What does Jesus do? You know, here's a man who's impotent, been laying there for 38 years, obviously maybe he's paralyzed, something's wrong with him, he can't get to the pool to be healed. So it speaks to the idea that he is paralyzed or immobile, cannot move. What does Jesus tell him to do? He tells him to do the thing that he can't do. He says to a man who can't get to some water in 38 years, Jesus says to a man who was unable to get in water for 38 years, he couldn't make his way into that water. But this same man who couldn't get down to some water in 38 years, Jesus tells him, rise, take up your bed and walk. He could have said, Lord, didn't I just tell you I have for 38 years, I can't move, I can't get up, I can't move. He could have said something like that. He was making excuses anyway. He could have said, and see, some people, they get angry. Some people, like I said in the dream, get angry and then make excuses. You know, rise, take up your bed and walk. What? Didn't you just hear what I said? See, you get angry, and then what? Didn't you just hear what I said? I told you, I've been here for 30 years, I have nobody to help me. So, angry and excuses, right? John chapter 5, read it for yourself. But here's what the man did. Rise, took up his bed, walked. How did he get healed? Following an instruction. Let me give you another one. John, there's another one. Let me see, what was it? In John chapter, that was John chapter 5. I know there was two of them in John, but, oh Lord, I tell you what, let me move on from that. Let's go to Naaman, 2 Kings chapter 5. Naaman, or Naaman, whichever you want to pronounce it. The leper comes to Elijah, the prophet, wants to be healed of his leprosy. He gets angry because Elijah doesn't come out to him and so on. But he's given an instruction. Did Elisha come out, lay his hands on him, speak a word of him in the name of Jesus, you know, speak the word only and whatever? Nope. Elisha says, go wash in the Jordan 7 times. Naaman, upset, wrath, in a rage, okay, leaves there. Servant says, hey, if you'd ask you to do something, so he humbles himself, does it. Dips in the Jordan 7 times, what happened? Healed. What did he get? An instruction. When he first goes to Elisha, because Elijah doesn't come out to him, do what he preconceived thought that he would do. I thought he would come out, call upon the name of his God, and lay his hand on the man, and I'd be healed. Had this preconceived. He didn't do any of that. Would have missed his healing by not following the instruction. Angry, in a rage. Does that sound familiar like the dream? Yep. Okay. Then excuses. I thought, you know, he's a man of stature and all like that. He's the captain of the host of the king of Syria and all that kind of stuff. He's upset about it, you know, and then he makes excuses. Aren't these other rivers far, and these other rivers better than the waters of the Jordan? He makes excuses that that water's dirty. Man, they wash their goats in that water, whatever, you know, and all that. So he's got excuses, anger and excuses. Sound familiar? But he humbles himself, follows the instruction, he's healed of his leprosy. Isn't that something? Right? That's how it is. You know, people, you know, God's trying to help you. See, because many, many times, God sends a word. In the Old Testament, Exodus chapter 16, they had no food. God says, okay, tell the people, go out. I'm going to send manna from heaven and all that. Well, he told them, go out, gather it. Gather enough just for the day. I'm going to send it every day. Because they didn't have faith. If you read it, they gathered a whole bunch and it rotted and all that. But here's the thing. They had to gather it. God sent it. It was outside their tent, but they had to get up, go out, and get it. Right? That's the instruction. If they don't follow the instruction and get out and gather it, well, they're going to sit in the house and starve to death. You see? So instruction all throughout the scripture. God, they needed water a couple of times. God said, Moses, smite the rock. The next time God says, hey, speak to the rock. Moses, whatever the reason, I don't know why, he didn't speak to it. He smote it. God gave them water, but he says, Moses, because you did this, you didn't allow me to get the glory and all like that, you're not going into the promised land. You see, but what was it? An instruction, okay? Moses didn't say, Lord, the people need water, and boom, out of the ground, here comes this gusher, you know, and they got all the water they need. Nope, God says, okay, smite this rock. Instruction. I can go on and on with places where people need, the woman that she had all this debt, 2 Kings 4 maybe, whatever, right, had all this debt, and the man of God says, go borrow pots, don't borrow a few. And according to her faith, she borrowed a bunch of pots, and the little cruse of oil she had kept multiplying. God supernaturally multiplied it until all those pots were full. She paid the debt, lived off of the rest. What did God give her, right? The number? What he did was he gave her an instruction. Go borrow pots. Don't borrow a few. Okay? And when she got those pots, she just went out and bought, you know, she could have borrowed 4 pots. That's enough. Carrying all these pots. She could have had an attitude like we do. You know, all these pots are gonna be, what am I doing? Well, she could have done it, but she said, I'm gonna follow this instruction. I got nothing to lose. Borrowed all the pots, had enough to pay off her debt and live. She and her sons, the Bible says, off of the rest. But that's what God wants to do. But the instruction comes, you get mad. Then you make excuses. Well, I'm tired of that, but I love him, but I love her, but these are my kids. You know, a lot of people, one of the reasons they have the issues they have with their kids is because these are my kids. Well, oh Lord, let me just pray. Okay, if you don't know Jesus, you know, and you want to know him, in spite of what I've said, say this with me right now. Dear God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sin. I receive Jesus as my Savior and Lord. Come into my heart. Fill me with your Spirit. Baptize me in your Holy Ghost with the manifestation of speaking in other tongues. I thank you for saving me. And as I have been freely forgiven, I freely forgive everyone and anyone who has sinned or trespassed against me in Jesus' name. Amen. If you said that prayer, you're saved, you're born again, and on your way to heaven. And I'd love to see you in time. Let me pray one more time. And Lord, I rebuke the spirit of offense right now in Jesus' name. I'd love to see you in time, but if I don't see you in time, I'll see you in eternity. Love you, want to remind you, Jesus Christ came that you might have life, that you might have it more abundantly. So stop dying and live.
Thank you for tuning in to The Time Is Now with Pastor E.I. Osborne Jr. and friends. We pray that this message has been a blessing to you. If you would like some information on anything you heard in today's episode, or to find out how you can have a relationship with Jesus Christ, please call us at 508-746-4085. If you would like a copy of this message, further information about our ministry, or to make a donation, please visit our website at www.eiosborne.org or correspond by mail at The Time Is Now, P.O. Box 3642, Plymouth, Massachusetts, 02361. On behalf of the ministry, thank you.